I got it. I got it! Eureka, I've got it! Put your jokes away, internet, because this scene makes absolutely perfect sense. Buckle up, kiddos, because we're gonna solve this one months before Nintendo releases Super Mario Odyssey to the world. Welcome to Game Theory. Now, before I blow the lid off Nintendo's big scheme for Mario Odyssey, I have, cue the trumpets, a special announcement. That's the best we could do for my big special announcement? All right, fine. Fine, whatever. For the next 2 weeks and the next 2 weeks only, you can get your hands on some new, special, limited edition theorist swag. I've been working in the background since the beginning of this year to get you loyal theorists some new, really high quality, and most importantly, fashionable merch to show off your theorist pride. And the first batch is finally here. I am so excited about this. It's finally here.
Show me what you got.
Absolutely, oh great giant head. My problem with a lot of geeky merch has always been that it's just a logo plastered on the center of a shirt. But a lot of fashion now is all about asymmetry and wraparound patterns. It's the type of stuff that I wear all the time, so boom! I've got you a cool asymmetric t-shirt of both the Game Theory and Film Theory logos wrapping around your body. I like to think that it's the logos giving you a big giant bear hug. Then, since us theorists aim to be smart, even if I sometimes misread my calculations and say the wrong things in the script, ba-da-ba-ba-ba, backpacking it. It's a theory backpack.
Yeah!
It is a Game Theory backpack. And since not everyone wants clickbaity Game Theory green all over their backs, I figured, let's just do a little surprise on the back. It's like the logo is playing peekaboo with you every time you take off the bag. It's a secret that'll just be between us theorists. Keeps the backpack fun, but also classy, so you limit the risk of getting made fun of by Brock or Josh or whatever your school bully's stereotypical name is. And lastly, it's dangerous to go alone, so take this, a fidget spinner. Don't let the internet haters get you down. They are legitimately fun. And because our logo is literally a circle, it's like a match made in heaven. And this ain't no cheapy plastic spinner either, so feel free to do whatever weird tossy, nose balancey tricks you want to do on it. Sky's the limit, go crazy. You can get these special limited edition items by smashing the link in the description. But you don't have to take my word for it. Take it away, Wolfie.
Smash, smash, smash them!
Thank you, Wolfie. And it's all being done at a price that's quite honestly a lot cheaper than a lot of other YouTuber merch I've seen. And not only that, but I'll be signing a bunch of the items that end up being sent out to you guys who order them, so you actually have a chance to not only get a limited edition item, but also a super special signed one. That said, they're only available, like I said, for the next 2 weeks, so get them now before they're gone. Take Wolfie's advice and smash the link and show off that theorist style, because fashion is a science. So be smart and look smart while doing it. It's theory wear. Alright, enough cranking up your sexiness levels to 11, it is time to theorize. Now, you might have caught wind of this, but Mario's height is kind of a big thing around here. And so, when Nintendo revealed the first trailer to Mario Odyssey and showed him super assassin brosing his way through Crisis City next to literal 10 feet tall giants, it was a try not to cringe challenge that I failed hardcore. And you guys lit me up on Twitter, so I knew that you felt my pain. And while at first I figured I'd ignore it until it went away, or we had just some in-game explanation, that just felt like giving up, and I hate giving up. So before E3 announcements about this game start explaining things away, I wanted to take a crack at this mystery, throw my hat into the ring, literally, since that seems to be a main mechanic of this game, to actually pick apart what's going on in this world. And let me assure you, Nintendo has not lost their minds. There is an actual explanation here, one that has existed for decades without any of us suspecting it. So buckle up your overalls and look out for creepy games of Double Dutch. It is time to legitimize Shigeru Miyamoto's latest fever dream. From the information in the trailer, Super Mario Odyssey, the much anticipated sequel to Super Mario Iliad, will feature Mario traveling around the world in the most aerodynamically inefficient ship ever. Now, if the title Odyssey didn't give that away for you, which in and of itself is a reference to the Greek epic poem by the same name all about Odysseus's journey home after the fall of Troy, a story literally about a trip around the world, well, you can tell based on the globe logo and the mission location shown off in the trailer. I mean, we have a land themed around Dia de los Muertos and Aztec pyramids, Cogwald, a land that appears to be an African rainforest with Metaton performing sprinkler duty, and then, of course, New York City. I'm assuming the New York level is a set of introductory missions rather than a connecting hub world like Peach's Castle, based on the checkpoint flag that we see right meow. Right there. It's also worth noting that we can tell that these are all discrete levels because the purple currency in each one varies. There are triangles in Mexico Land, mechanical nuts in the forest world, fruit in the kitchen kingdom, and purple coins in the city. So, if the game is true to its namesake, this will be a story about Mario traveling to foreign lands in a quest to return home to the Mushroom Kingdom. But if we're not in the Mushroom Kingdom anymore, Toto, then where are we? Well, for the theory today, I'm most interested in the city. And you can immediately see that the name of the New York level is New Donk City, as in New Donkey Kong City. And if having that spelled out in poster form behind Mario's head in the opening seconds of the trailer was a bit too subtle for you to convince you of the connection, you can also tell from the humongous number of references to the Donkey Kong series throughout this thing. There's Diddy Mart, that one's pretty obvious, but if you look closer at the street signs, there's also Dixie Theater and Dixie Street, referring of course to Dixie Kong from Donkey Kong Country 2, Cranky Avenue, the name of the OG Kong, and K. Rool Place, the main villain from the Donkey Kong franchise. And if you really know your DKC lore, you'll even recognize the names Squawks, Espresso, and Rambi, your helper animals from Donkey Kong Country 1. But it doesn't stop there. Even the pink scaffolding from the original Donkey Kong arcade game can be seen peppering the city, and the taxi that pulls up at the opening of the trailer has the number 1981 on its license plate, a reference to the arcade game being released in the year 1981. So very clearly, New Donk City is somehow connected with Donkey Kong lore, but how? And what's any of that got to do with 10 feet tall human beings? Creatures that are literally twice the size of Mario. One word, everything. Because we've been overlooking a huge fact since the beginning. Gigantism in the Donkey Kong canon has always existed. We just never stopped to notice it before. Flashback to Pauline. When Mario stands next to his lady love in his very first game, they aren't exactly eye to eye. It's more like eye to waistline. And while we all assume that this was a creative decision due to technological limitations of the time or that Mario was without his mushroom, it's actually a size difference that Nintendo has continued to keep canon to this day without us realizing it. Just take one look at the Mario vs. Donkey Kong franchise where Pauline makes a reappearance and she's still towering over her mustachioed manicotti. But that's actually a small example. Fast forward to the first Donkey Kong Country game for the Super Nintendo, an incredible, groundbreaking game that paved the way for Rare to dominate platformers for the next two console generations. And visually, it is stunning. The use of 3D sprites was something unheard of at that time. But for as visually beautiful as it is, it's also worth noting that this is a world that makes sense. The proportions all feel in the range of what would be natural. Relative to Donkey Kong and the Kremlings, the trees aren't excessively big or tall, the snakes and birds that you fight against are all fairly average in size, the rock formations and caves feel natural, and yet, at the end of each world, you come up against a boss. A boss, mind you, that just so happens to be a giga-sized version of one of the normal enemies from the surrounding region. There's Master Necky Sr., Really Naughty, the giant Bumblebee, to name three. They're absolute giants relative to the size of everyone else. So that prompts the question, how did they get so big? Well, they all have one thing in common, the banana horde. You see, the whole game revolves around the theft of Donkey Kong's bananas. And it's worth noting that these aren't just any bananas. There are plenty of those lying around each world. No, these are Donkey Kong's special bananas, the ones stolen from him at the beginning of the game. Bananas that, as luck would have it, just so happen to be supersized. And when you fight bosses in the game, you battle them in an arena composed of Donkey Kong's stolen bananas. So you have gigantic, oversized bosses that happen to be the ones who also happen to steal the gigantic, oversized bananas. I mean, don't get me wrong, who doesn't want a large banana after all, but seriously, it seems to me that there could be a connection between the enormous size of the bosses and Donkey Kong's enormous bananas. It's also worth noting that in the sequels DKC 2 and 3, they don't have bosses at the scale that we see in DKC 1. I mean, there's a handful of slightly larger ones, but nothing like we see with Master Necky, and in both of those games, the banana horde isn't actually in the enemy's possession. So the fact that there are no oversized, gigantic bosses make sense. But there's even more, because the coincidences just get weirder when you actually stop to ask. Why is everyone interested in stealing Donkey Kong's bananas in the first place? King K. Rool starts off the series by ordering his minions to steal the banana horde, then kidnaps Donkey Kong in the second country game, holding him in ransom until he gets payment of the Kong banana stash. And he's just an alligator, so it's not like he's interested in them to eat them or anything. And it's not just him. In Donkey Kong Country Returns, the Tiki Tak tribe also tries to get their hands on Donkey's banana. And I don't mean in a Game Theory gone sexual kind of way either. Again, there is no real explanation for why they want them. And you might think that this is all just limited to the Donkey Kong universe, but it's not. The Banana Horde even appears in Super Smash Bros. Brawl story mode, The Subspace Emissary, where Bowser of all people, sends out a Hammer Bro and a Goomba to steal DK's bananas. Bowser, the Turtle Sorcerer King, a literal king, a guy who claimed galaxies for himself. What's he want with a bunch of fruits? So clearly, there's more to this fruit than meets the eye. And in fact, we do know that these bananas possess magical properties. As seen in Donkey Kong Country Returns Factory Level, a tiki can come to life when a mashed up banana is incorporated into its body. This is further demonstrated with the final battle against Tiki Tong, where he turns the bananas into banana juice and uses it to transform his hands, making him stronger for the battle against the Kongs. So it is definitely possible that these bananas possess all sorts of properties, even to the extent of being the DKC universe's equivalent of Mario's super mushrooms, making things grow to enormous sizes. In fact, there's even a scientific basis to all of this. Theoretically, if you look at how the biology works, it is possible for bananas to supercharge the height of humans. You see, bananas have a lot of nutrients in them. They have a lot of the stuff we need, but they also have stuff that we just don't need that much of. Some of the stuff in bananas, like vitamins and fiber, great, keep me regular, keep the bowels happy and healthy. But there are some other things in bananas that we only need a little bit of. Take our buddy tyrosine, an essential amino acid, but one that your body usually makes enough of on its own. It's only a little molecule, but it packs a huge punch because it controls massive processes that take place in your brain's hormonal regulatory center, the pituitary gland. This one tiny part of your brain controls everything about you, from whether you feel depressed to how big you grow. People take tyrosine supplements for a lot of different reasons, but the one I'm gonna focus on today is bodybuilding, because tyrosine can adjust your body's production of growth hormone. Bodybuilders wanna be massive and get their swole on, bro, and they believe that tyrosine is the gateway to becoming bigger, buffer, and becoming the ultimate gorilla juice head, which, in the context of Donkey Kong, is very ironic. But as you can imagine, you can have too much of a good thing. Too much human growth hormone relative to the other stuff in your body can lead to your pituitary gland getting way out of whack, producing too much growth that leads to disorders like acromegaly, which is what Andre the Giant, famous wrestler and classic actor from The Princess Bride, had, and why he was so much bigger and taller than everyone around him. All this is possible when you supercharge your pituitary with too much tyrosine, or, in our case, have a population that's eating supercharged tyrosine-infused bananas. That's right, the thing that's giving the Donkey Kong bosses their enormous stature is also making the citizens of New Donk City super massive next to little old banana-less Mario. Womp 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 womp, Mario's got a tiny banana. So what about the humans in New Donk? Why would the bananas affect them, of all people? Well, in the literal opening second of the trailer, we're able to make out three additional signs peppering the streets of New Donk, references to three restaurants feeding the population of the city: Candy's Cafe, Tiny's Piroshki, and Banana Bagel. More references, as Candy is Donkey Kong's girlfriend in the Country series, and Tiny is from DK64. And for those who are wondering, a piroshki is a Russian mini pie that's either fried or baked and can be filled with different sweet, savory, or sour fixins. Regardless, we have two restaurants that are themed around the Kong family, maybe even run by the Kong family, as well as one that outright says that it serves banana bagels. To me, it's definitely possible, if not probable, that these places are serving up dishes using the secret ingredient. And no, I don't mean love. I mean Donkey Kong's special bananas with the power to make things grow to enormous sizes. Hence, why the Donkey Kong Country universe humans are so much bigger than the Mushroom King Kingdom residents like Mario. It's all part of a balanced diet. But hey, that's just some merch that you can buy for a limited time. 2 weeks only. Click the link in the description below. Oh yeah, and by the way, this was a theory. A game theory. Can't wait to see you guys wearing your theorist swag. We'll see how this theory holds up post E3. Fingers crossed. Check out the backpacks, they are amazing.